Good morning, friends. Good morning. Right, so before going into class, I need to share something with you. Okay, I need to clarify certain things. Point one, see, what is the intention of this assignment note that we have to clearly understand? Right, so before understanding the need of assignment note, we have to first understand one thing. With respect to civil services, you are newborn, but you are aiming to participate in Olympics. Right? It will take some time. Just now you have started crawling, then you have to stand, you have to walk, then run, then you have to change your dietary methods, etc. Only then you can go to that stage. But what generally people do, they want to immediately go and taste the stadium experience. So you immediately start writing questions by seeing in internet. Are you able to get my point? We have to gradually grow, that we have to understand. The assignment note and the classes are conceptualized in such a way that, you know, keeping your evolution in mind. So what I am trying to do with the assignment note? I am giving you three topics every day. Yes or no? Two with respect to prelims. One is with respect to mains. With respect to topic per se, there is no difference. With respect to taking notes, there is some difference. Okay. So what is the difference in taking notes between prelims and mains, sir? To understand that, Nick, okay, I would like to take an analogy. I hope everyone would have seen Titanic movie. So imagine Titanic movie is the subject or topic. Okay, like greenhouse gases or India-Pakistan relationship. I am saying Titanic movie plot is the topic. I give it to you in prelims. So what you will do? Titanic. Which year it was built? Let's say early 1900s. Okay, early 20th century, 1912 if I am not wrong. Right? Similarly, who is the captain? When it was commissioned? Whatever. Some basic facts we will be writing. Maybe we can also write the technology involved if at all we want. If it is mains, okay, if it is a 3-hour story, if I am asking her, can you please brief me about the story? Do you think she'll be taking 3 hours to explain? No, definitely no. She'll be summarizing it in 3 minutes. This is the plot. That summary is what is means. If I ask you to summarize the plot, you have to summarize in such a way that within 3 minutes you have to give me an idea. Within the page limit, you have to give me an idea. But I can slightly change the orientation. Say, for example, I'm putting a question like this. List out the reasons for the failure of Titanic as a ship. Then she will not be telling the story. She will be saying the reasons why it met an accident. Are you clear? This is what the difference with respect to mains and prelims. Or I will put a question like this. Discuss the ecological damage caused by Titanic. What you will write? You can start from the building, built up of ship. Okay, so much amount of wood has been used, which resulted in deforestation. So much amount of steel has been used. Okay, that resulted in some sort of contamination in air with respect to air pollution. Let's say the oil spills resulted in affecting the marine ecosystem in the seas. Okay, it also disturbed an iceberg. Okay, that also disturbed that kind of ecosystem in that area. Yes or no? I'm not telling the story, but I am orienting myself towards the need of the question. Another question I can say. Discuss the rich-poor divide in the context of Titanic movie. How will you see? The hero is poor, heroine is rich. What are the discrimination he faced? That we can list out. Or I am saying, discuss the level of patriarchy in 1900s. Patriarchy, male domination. Though the heroine was rich, right? She was facing male domination. On that lines, I can take some points. Are you able to get my point? But what people do? We ask a question. Now there is a mention of Titanic. They write the plot of Titanic. And they expect us to give some marks. So I am trying to give this orientation. First, initially, you will not be in a position to completely write what is the need. You will not be in a position to understand what is the actual need. So I am trying to give some orientation. If I say prelims, immediately your mind construct changes. If I say mains, immediately you look into the question. That is why I frame as Very simpler question, but I frame it into a question. For prelims, I simply give a topic. For mains, I make it into a question so that I give some orientation. We came across an article with respect to water shortage, I mean water crisis in Shimla. That was a full page article. But what was my question? I asked reasons, so I am orienting. That is the story, you take only the reasons. I can similarly say, do you agree that the misgovernance has led to the ongoing crisis in Shimla? Then you have to orient yourself with respect to the misgovernance. After that, we have something called as examine, critically analyze, discuss, explain, list out, enumerate. So for which we have to again orient on a different way. But to reach this place, we need to travel some distance. For which you have to do your exercise every day. Are you clear? So, and also one more thing. People come and ask, sir, you asked me a question on greenhouse. You gave me an assignment on greenhouse gas in prelims. But there is no mention about it in the paper. So where do I search? See, there will be a mention. There was an article, it will call as Green Ambitions. Where there was a mention about greenhouse gases. What that article says about? The Green Ambition says, let's say India is largely dependent on coal. In producing, our power capacity is 343 gigawatts. Current power capacity. Out of which, 60% of the power generation is based on coal. So the coal results in emission of certain greenhouse gases that affects, that results in global warming. So we have some international obligations to reduce our emissions. So, when we focus large amount of our energy demands through renewable energy, let's say solar, let's say wind. So India is having an ambitious target of generating 175 gigawatts by 2022 out of 343 gigawatts of power capacity currently. By 2022, we are aiming to generate 175 gigawatts from solar, not solar, renewables. Currently, our renewables share is around 70 gigawatts. Out of 343, we are generating 70 gigawatts from renewables. But we are aiming to generate 175 gigawatts from renewables by 2022. So what will happen? Solar is a clean energy. Wind is a clean energy. I am reducing the demand, need for coal. So automatically, my emission reduces. That is why there was a mention about greenhouse gases. To completely understand this article, we need to know what is greenhouse gas. So I lifted the topic. You will not find answer in Hindu. Remember, Hindu is not written exclusively keeping UPSC aspirants in mind. Right? So we have to extract what is required from the paper. So you have to go to Google, you have to search. So one person came. He came and he was completely shocked. He said, sir, I am not able to take notes. My hands are paining. What happened? Show me your notes. He wrote whatever from the first word. He wrote everything which was present in Wikipedia about greenhouse gases. So he completed some 15-20 pages on greenhouse gases. So he is saying, sir, I do not know where to stop. It appears everything is important. That is why I said, please answer why, what, how, when, something like that. And that is why I also gave page restriction. Okay, in the given space, whatever you feel important, you write. You make some mistake, no problem. Next day, I will give you model notes. Okay, so with that models, you can compare. Okay, am I thinking in the lines of UPSC? Am I in tune with the demands of UPSC? So you yourself can do the course correction. Are you clear? So another point, people come and ask me, sir, you gave about some 5-6 points on greenhouse gases. So is it sufficient? Is it over? So I need not do anything more than that, right? That is also not correct. See, UPSC is not a street fight. It is a war. Okay? It will take some time. We cannot annex the enemy country in a single day. Slowly we have to conquer. Today I read something about greenhouse gases. When there is a mention about greenhouse gases, maybe after 2 or 3 weeks, let's assume that there is an international convention which is going to be held in another 3 or 4 weeks in Paris. Again, there will be a mention about greenhouse gases in paper. Then you expand your knowledge. And in the center page article, editorials, suddenly when there is more debate is going on a particular area, let's say greenhouse gases, there will be an editorial on greenhouse gases. Learned people on that area, they will be discussing. So from that article, you can take large amount of clues. You can further expand your knowledge. Right? This will come again and again and again. If it is not coming, in that day, that is not important. UPSC will not focus much. That limited knowledge is sufficient. And there are certain things which everybody should know that will be taken care of in the conventional classes. Let's say SEO, Shanghai Cooperation Organization. That is a very important topic. Right now, you may take like this. Let's say, for example, what is SEO? Where is its headquarters? Who are the members? What is the structure? What is the mandate? So, what is the structure? What is the mandate? Right? Any important information is there. Maybe one or two points, you may take it. Not more than that, we'll be doing it right now. But in class, since it is very important, a larger picture about SEO will be taken care. If it is so important, that will be a part of your class. As of now, you limit your search. If you keep on searching, it will take definitely not less than 2 days to complete on Hindu. But unfortunately, as of now, we cannot spend more than 3 or 4 hours. Maximum. Maybe after 1 month, your residual knowledge would have increased. Let's say now you have an idea of greenhouse gases. When you come again about greenhouse gases in paper, you will not do the basic research. You will do only updation. You will save time. That is why if you sincerely do Hindu for 100 days, you know, you will be able to read the Hindu in less than 90 minutes, including taking notes, right? And one more thing, people come and ask me, sir, why to do this, why to put this much effort? There are various online sources. They are coming up with various materials, Hindu just, that just, this just, etc. So it is also very easier to understand, why not, you know, do that directly, so that we can save a large amount of time, we can put more amount of energy in conventional subject. If you compare the weightage of conventional and current affairs is more. But the point is to understand current affairs, we need convention. Both have to be go parallelly. Okay, so don't think current affairs has a lesser importance. But what is the problem in directly depending upon them, sir? As I said, UPSC is a war. Okay, whatever the way you take notes, the way you understand, okay, the way you recollect, that is the strategy to win the war. Okay, the material you make, that is the weapon you have, right? Without exercise, without strategy, okay? If you simply have get a weapon from online source, you cannot win the war. Are you getting my point? Those are weapons, but you have to know your own strength, own weakness. Accordingly, you have to make your own weapon. Through the process, you will devise your own strategy. Only then you can win this war. Right, so you guys are having so much of luxury to prepare, you know, all through the day. You are not working professionals. Maybe some of them would be doing their final year college. Apart from that, most of them are preparing exclusively for civil services, right? So there are values. You have to do only these things. Okay, so keep this point in mind. Don't get bored. Try to build some curiosity, we have no other choice. Right? Clear as soon as possible. And yes, we will be released from this vicious cycle. Adurke maatikittom. Fine. So today, we will try to cover some larger area. And one more important thing, after the class in the ERP, a weekly magazine will be uploaded. Okay, just now you said don't depend on external weapons. Now you yourself are giving me a weapon. No, that is not a weapon at all. Okay, maybe it is something like a tool which used to sharpen your weapon. Abadina think panikalam. Okay, so what I am trying to do is, I take the previous week's compilation, I give the previous week's compilation in that book, keeping your knowledge in mind, I have made it as simple as possible. Point number one. Point number two, that week's syllabus will be covered in today's class. But not all the topics, that is humanly impossible. In given 2.5 hours, I cannot complete 1 week's syllabus. But I know which is the difficult part, which is the most important part, where you need my support, those areas will be taken care. Other areas you have to do it by reading the magazine. Right? So what you have to do, every week you have to read Hindu. Then you come to class. I will be picking up the important areas from Hindu and other sources, I'll be discussing. Second iteration, with respect to current affairs. Third iteration, you go home, download the copy and do that. Third iteration. Fourth one, every day you have to do assignments. Fourth point. Fifth one, from July 1st week, every Monday you'll be having test. Clear? The test for prelims come mains. You'll be having MCQs, rate will be finalized. But from July it will be starting. It's not whether Monday or which date, okay? So there'll be weekly test. These five things along with this, everyday revision of your classes. You have to do this again and again and again and again and again. Okay, then the exam will be like a cakewalk. Okay, it will not be a very big deal. Everyone can clear. There are around 1,000 vacancies. In this class, we have 200 people. It is possible. Mathematically possible. Right? So we can strive for that. Great. The first topic. See, GP term which appears in paper again and again and again. Okay. I'm not going to go in deep about GDP because Israel will be taking care of GDP. It is a very big concept. But first we have to understand, at least to study the news, we need to know what is GDP, right? GDP is a tool to measure the nation's income. It's a tool to measure nation's income. Let's say I can measure India's income through various tools. GDP is one such tool. What are the various tools? What are the other kinds? That will be taken care of in class. So when you come across GDP, GDP has grown. That means nation's income has grown. GDP growth rate is hovering around 6 to 6.5%. That means, okay, some of our growth is positive. Since they are hovering, we are not able to pick up the higher growth rate. So we have to understand in such a way. Recently, Nithya Yoga Vice Chairman gave an interview on Hindu, right, where he mentioned that we have the capacity to grow more than 8%. GDP is an indicator of growth. That's all sufficient. Okay. Very important topic. See, bankruptcy code. Okay. From prelims point of view, from mains point of view. Okay. Right. So first, let me give you an idea about this IBC. Then we will do the slides. See, what is the difference between insolvency and bankruptcy? What is the difference between insolvency and bankruptcy? So insolvency is a state of being insolvent. I have borrowed some money. I am not able to repay. And I am not able to repay my dues. Then I will be considered as an insolvent. Okay. So insolvent is a state. Insolvency is a state of being insolvent. Now, what is bankruptcy? So, bankruptcy is nothing but court says, yes, he is an insolvent. Right? So, it is a, insolvency is a state of being insolvent. So, bankruptcy is a state where court puts an order. Yes, he is insolvent. Now, he is bankrupt. He is not in a position to give back the money. Clear? So, In 2016, government came up with an act called as Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. See, listen, need not write anything. Everything is clearly given in the PPT that you will be receiving it in your ERP. Just listen to the story. Okay, it is slightly complicated, but easy only. Right? 2016, they came with an act, IBC. Why? To regulate these insolvency proceedings. Okay, we already saw in last class about NPA. I borrow money, do not repay for more than 90 days, then that asset will be classified as NPA. There are large amount of issues circling around non-repayment of debts. So, in order to ease out that issue, and also for some other reason, what reason we will say, government came with something called as IBC. So, through this IBC, either an individual or an entity, a firm, either an individual or an entity, they can go for insolvency process. They can go for insolvency resolution. See, someone they have to approach, right? I have borrowed, I am not able to repay. You people come and torture me. I need to escape. I am not able to repay. I have some genuine reason. Someone I have to approach. Earlier I go to police station. Earlier I go to court. Now, through this insolvency bankruptcy code, Government says there is an adjudicating authority exclusively for individuals and corporates. For individuals, go and meet an authority called as Debt Recovery Tribunal. What is a tribunal, sir? Difference between tribunal courts, it is a Rangasaru Dekaran quality. So as of now, tribunal means it's a quasi-judicial body similar to courts. And exclusive courts which will take up the cases only with respect to bankruptcy. Right? I need not approach High Court or some other district courts. So if I am individual, go and meet DRT. Go and initiate, file a case or initiate the process with respect to resolution. Express your willingness. Help me. You know, I'm having some problem. NTT, go and approach National Company Law Tribunal. NCLT. Are you clear? So now, who can initiate this insolvency proceedings? The debtor can initiate. So who can initiate? One is debtor. That means the borrower. The borrower or debtor can initiate this insolvency proceedings. And similarly, even the creditor, the lender, he can also initiate. Let's say, I have given money, they are torturing me, sorry, I have borrowed money, I am not able to repay, I can go and get the help from DRT. Okay, I have given money to him, he is not paying me back, again I can go to these people for some help. Right? So, debtor also can initiate, creditor also can initiate. In this creditor, we have two kinds. So, one is financial creditor and another one is operational creditor. So financial creditor means I have given money to him, right? So I am a financial creditor. Operational creditor, he is running some business, I am leasing out some machinery for which he is not paying me rent. I am operational creditor. Both can go and initiate insolvency proceedings. Are you clear? So if it is for individual, and individual, either the borrower or the lender is approaching DRT. Now there are two stages. One is start afresh. That means the DRT will slightly give some debt reconstruction. Let's say I have borrowed 1 lakh rupees. Now the debtor and DRT will come to an consensus. Let's say debtor, I say DRT is asking me how much I can repay. Sir, I can repay 50,000. DRT says no, 50,000 is very less, pay 75,000. Some consensus will come. Now for 75,000, I'll start afresh. I'll be paying interest, I'll be repaying the principal amount for the 75,000 from the beginning. This is start afresh. First one, okay, I'm starting freshly. Second one, again, the creditor and the debtor. Creditor will see, is there any viability? Is there any possibility to sell this asset, something like that, to recover the amount? And there is no such possibility, then the individual will go for insolvency. Now DRT will look up the case and they will announce if there is no possibility to recover the money, then it will be announced as an bankrupt. Are you clear? Yes. Now you have borrowed me 10 lakh rupees. Now you are not able to give me back entire 10 lakhs. But if it is 5 lakhs, with your current earnings, you can pay me back. They are asking me to give some waive off. Write off some of my loan, sir. Right? So a kind of pardoning. Right? See, for the lender, instead of you announcing as bankrupt, I'll be happy at least I get 5 lakh 6 lakh rupees. Something is better than nothing. Clear? So if it is for a company, okay, if it is for a company, I approach NCLT. So now this NCLT will immediately appoint a professional called as resolution professional. Resolution professional. Okay. So, I go, let's assume that Guna's corporate. I go for resolution process. So, the NCLT is appointing an professional. He may be an advocate or he may be an MBA graduate. Some professional will be appointed to take up my case. Okay. That person comes to me. And he finds all the creditors. Many people would have given money to me. ICICI would have given money to me. Muthoot Finance would have given money to me. Axis Bank would have given money to me. IOB would have given money to me. So it will bring all the creditors together and he will constitute a committee called as Creditors Committee. you will constitute a committee called as creditors committee. Now this committee will be given 180 days of time. With that 180 days of time, this committee has to come up with a resolution plan. So what is the resolution plan? How effectively we can extract the money from the Guna's corporate. Let's say definitely he has borrowed 10 crore rupees. He is not in a position to give back the entire 10 crore. So what shall we do? Shall we reduce the interest rates? Or shall we extend the repayment period? He need not pay in another 5 years. Let him take 50 years. So that the EMI will reduce. Yes or no? Some debt restructuring will be done. Okay, they will be arriving at some plan. But the point is, 75% of the creditors committee should say yes for that plan. If there is no consensus in 180 days, an additional 90 days will be given. Grace time will be given. Within that 90 days, they have to come up with a plan. If they are not coming up with a plan, in that situation, NCLT will go for something called as liquidation of assets. Liquidation of assets. That means NCLT will order to sell all my assets. Let's say the NCLT will order to, it will confiscate my property, it will sell my projector, AC, light, table, so that it can recover some amount of money and that money can be given to the creditors. Are you able to get my point? Right? So if it is a normal company, small company, or some special entity, timing will be 90 days plus another 45 days. If it is a bigger company, 180 plus maximum 90. If it is a smaller company, it is going to be 90 days plus 45 days. Are you clear? Yes, yes. Selling the assets. See, I am having my company. Let's say my assets, I own the property. Okay, I own the machineries. I have 10 buses, Benz car. Okay, but I owe a debt of, let's say, 1 crore rupees. By selling my 10 buses, they can get the money. Okay, so he will order for liquidation. He will analyze, he will assess. The NCLT will assess all my assets. So he will take a part of my assets and it will sell. He will give the, recover the money and he will be giving it to the creditors. Individual. Ah, yes. Creditors. No. See, DRT is a mediator. Individual goes and individual and DRT is interacting and I am pleading in front of DRT. If DRT says that okay, 75,000 you repay. Some amount, yes. So he is making it more sustainable. He is making it is more viable because he needs some amount of money. See, imagine we discussed NPA. Bank is not able to recover from an individual. If he goes to debt asset reconstruction company, any of he is going to cut an amount. Yes or no? That year DRT will do it and within 180 days. The money will be within 6 months, the problem will be solved. If he takes to the court, average years of pending, any case, it takes on an average of 4.3 years of time, which was mentioned in economic survey recently. For any case, on an average, if I approach in court, in high courts especially, for any cases, it takes around 4.3 years on an average to get the case to be completed. For civil case, it will take even much more time. It is civil case though. So DRT is giving a solution in a maximum of six months plus 90 days, 9 months. So it is a way to resolve the NPA. But that was not the actual intention for creating IBC. It was one of the intention. Main intention was to make the exit more easier. In India, starting up a business is easy, but winding up a business is very difficult because there are large amount of company laws which will not allow us to close because there are large amount of population employees that depend on that company. Just like that, a company cannot close its operations. So there is some procedure. So for exiting, there is a delay in India to facilitate the exit. Let's say if that person, wants to go for liquidation, maximum of 180 days. In 6 months, he can wind up the company. And with that money, he can start new business. Are you able to get my point? So to facilitate exit and also to facilitate the recovery of non-performing assets, this IBC code will be helpful. Now you may ask, sir, is NCLT or DRT? They are passing an order. That order, either it may not be okay for creditors or it may not be okay for debtors. She asked, I have borrowed 1 lakh rupees. Now I myself and DRT are interacting. DRT says, you have to pay at least 75,000. The borrower is also okay. Okay, sir, I'll pay 75,000. Now he is the lender. He comes and asks me. He's asking the DRT. See, how can I decide? How can I lose 25% of my money? So he wants an appeal. So the appeal against DRT or appeal against NCLT can go to an institution called as Debt Recovery Appellate Tribunal for Individuals and National Company Law Appellate Tribunals for Company. Are able to get my point? See, generally we go and file a case in district court. In police station, the case goes to district court. If you are not happy with the verdict, they go for high court. If they are not happy with the verdict of high court, they go to Supreme Court. Similarly, I am not happy with the verdict, either borrower or lender of DRT, they go to DRAT. Again, I am not happy with the verdict of DRAT or NCLT. Now I can approach Supreme Court. I need not go to High Court, I can approach Supreme Court. This can be a prelims question. Is there any appellate authority? What is the appellate procedures? Are you clear? Now, this Insolvency Bankruptcy Code comes with 4 important pillars. So what are those 4 important pillars or 4 important institutions? First S. Sorry? See, they will go announce in newspaper that there will be an auctioning process. Mercedes-Benz owned by Vijay Mallya. Okay, starting amount 10 lakh rupees. Whoever purchases, they will get the money. Don't go into technicalities, not necessary. How it works, how practically, how it happened. We may be curious, but it will lead large amount of time. Okay, vittu kuduthuranga ma avladha. See, for farmers, there is a different exception. There is something called a surfacing act, where the act itself says that we cannot confiscate the farmer's land. I have to come up with a different solution, viable solution. I can't simply confiscate his property. Okay, that is a separate topic, which will come under something called a surfacing act, which Israel will be doing. You need not worry about it. Some question. Sorry? Written? Of course, yes. I'll show you everything. Whatever I say, it is given in the slides. It is also given in the magazine. Need not worry about it. Okay? Yes. No, that is not very clear in the act. That will be given in the annexure, not required. Okay, let me complete. Then we'll also discuss. Okay? So yes, so what are the 4 important institutions? One is the regulator. There is an institution who regulates the entire proceedings, that is called as Insolvency Bankruptcy Board of India, which has 10 members from RBI and Finance Ministry. Clear? Point number 2, another institution is Resolution Professional, which we saw. As soon as I go for a resolution process in NCLT, he will appoint a professional who takes care of entire process. That is Resolution Professional. The third institution is called as Information Utility. Information Utility. This is a large... Any loans, anything, okay. Just don't mistake me. I'll complete this topic. Then we'll have a discussion, okay, fine. But if you're not able to understand what I'm trying to say, then you can stop me. I'll repeat it, right? So Information Utility, it is a centralized database, a large database, which is created under this Insolvency Bankruptcy Code of India. Okay, all the creditors are asked to submit the information of debtors to the centralized database. I borrow some money from IOB. If I go into the database, if they type my name and some information, they will know what is the amount of money I have bought from IOB, whether I am prompt in repaying the money or not. It is a database of information about the debtors. The another institution is IBBA, RP, Information Utility. Then we have the adjudicating authorities. So they are nothing but the NCLT and the DRT. Clear? So in 2017, government came with an ordinance to amend. What is an ordinance? Avasara Sattam. Okay. It bypasses the regular lawmaking process and suddenly a law will be enacted. All the difference will be taken care of in quality. Don't worry about it. As of now, it is also a law. By 2017, government made some amendment to the provisions of the original IBC. Accordingly, now according to this amendment in 17, see earlier, the creditors committee, they have to have a majority of 75%. So now they have reduced it to, this is 18. Wait. Okay. That is 18 of my ordinance. I am sorry. So in 2017, they are asking the resolution professional and creditors committee to carefully study about the resolution applicant. Let's say I am a resolution applicant. I apply for resolution. Right? Now, before coming into a plan, before arriving at a plan, this creditors committee should carefully study about him. Whether he is a willful defaulter. What is willful defaulter? I borrow, I do not repay, I come for resolution. I am an habitual offender. Or you have to check whether I have imprisoned for more than 2 years or not. Or they have to check whether I have an NPA for more than 1 year or not. Or they have to check whether SEBI has banned me in doing some trading or investments. So they will check. And if I fall under such category, then I will not be eligible for initiating a resolution. So they made the norms more stricter in 2017. Now in 2018 June, through an ordinance, they are further amending the act. The first one, they are saying, the allottees in real estate projects, let's say I have given some 1 crore rupees for purchasing a flat. So I am an allottee of that flat. Now this allottee is considered as financial creditor. That means what? I have given money to get a flat. He is not giving the flat on time. In that situation, I can initiate resolution in insolvency proceedings against him in NCLT. The grievance is a redressal mechanism. I have an issue. Instead of approaching a court, I can approach NCLT. Clear? So real estate allot, I mean real property allottee is considered as an financial creditor. Point number two is with respect to the majority part. Earlier it was 75%. Now it has been brought down to 51%. And for certain areas, it has been brought down to 66%. For example, if the creditors committee is not happy with the resolution professional, then creditors committee with 66% of consensus, they can change the resolution professional. See, remember, the role of resolution professional is very crucial. In the 180 days, the resolution professional will take over the management of the company which has come for insolvency proceedings. Guna's corporate or Guna's company, you know, is approached NCLT for insolvency proceedings. NCLT will appoint an RP. RP will gather all the creditors. I will make a committee. And in the 180 days, I have no say in the management of my company. I have to walk out that RP will take over my management of my company. And RP will be doing the administration for 180 days. And the guidance will be given by creditors committee. Based on the bank's guidance, this RP will be conducting my business. I have to walk out for 180 days. Are you clear? So the role of RP is also very crucial. If that RP has to be changed, he can be changed. Right? So from prelims point of view, there is a change in the majority consensus. For what areas, what has it changed? That we need not, you know, prepare for, but advocates will take care. Okay, this exam is for generalists, not for specialists. Clear? So we need to know what is the score, what impact it is going to create on society. Right? So third one. third one. So earlier, the person has got a loan, he is not able to repay for more than 1 year. His loan is in NPA condition for more than 1 year. He is banned from applying for resolution. Yes or no? According to the original code, but according to the amended code, if he is an entity, if it is an individual, again he is banned. He has borrowed money, he is not repaid for more than 1 year, he cannot apply for resolution. Earlier, in his track record, he is having an NPA for 1 year. Then he is not eligible for applying for resolution. But if it is a financial entity, they can apply for resolution process. So for entity, there is some advantage. And another thing, with respect to resolution plan, so this committee forms a group and they devise a plan, a viable plan to recover the company. This plan can be submitted by the committee, or the plan can be submitted by any outsider. Anybody can submit the plan, okay, to turn around the business of the company, to help the company in repaying the debt, right? Earlier there was a condition, a guarantor cannot come with a resolution plan. So who is the guarantor? Let's say Guna's corporate or some company, and he has given, I have borrowed 1 crore rupees from IOB and he has given guarantee for me. Now he is my guarantor. Earlier, this guarantor cannot give a resolution plan. Right? Now, this IBC has been amended in such a way that this guarantor can also give a resolution plan with one condition. What is the condition, sir? Let's assume that he has given guarantee. Okay, she is the lender, I am the borrower. I do not repay. She is not asking the guarantor at all. She directly goes to the tribunal. In this situation, he can give a resolution plan. We'll take another situation. She is asking money, I am not able to repay. She is asking the guarantor, he is also not able to repay. In that situation, he cannot give a resolution plan. Clear? Slightly they are amending the procedure, right? And this NPA condition and this guarantor condition is not applicable for MSMEs. Micro, small, medium scale enterprises has some advantage over in this area. Are you clear? And also earlier, if a person has been imprisoned for more than 2 years, he is not eligible to apply, right? So now they have changed it. After 2 years, they can apply with respect to certain cases, certain notified cases, right? So I would have committed a crime for various things, okay? They are listing out certain cases. For these cases, they are completely prohibiting. For these cases, after 2 years, we can allow them for resolution proceedings. That amendment. Another thing, to exit. See, I have applied for resolution. Now, I want to leave. I want to withdraw the application for resolution. In that situation, 90% of the creditors committee should say yes. Only then, we can withdraw the resolution proceedings. Are you clear? These are the amendments which came recently for the original insolvency bankruptcy code through the ordinance. Are you clear? It is all about resolving the debt. It is all about recovering the debt. It is all about facilitating the exit in a short period of time. Whatever we have done is only for prelims. This is more important, so we are going into the each individual provisions. We need not dig more than this. This is sufficient. What is main, sir? In the center page articles, now we will be seeing. In coming years, it will be coming. They will analyze the impact. They will take up the point of 75% to 51%. You have reduced to 51%. Let's say, I will say one criticism. Let's say there are 10 lenders. One borrower. Out of 10 lenders, let's say 9 lenders have given 1 crore and the remaining 1 lender has given me 10 crores. All 9 together, they have given me only 1 crore. The another person has given me 10 crores. To have consensus, 51 is sufficient. Let's say 6 of them are easily saying yes. And the last one person saying no. What is the impact? There is one criticism to this act. I am highlighting this. So these Points will be highlighted, positive, negatives will be discussed from various perspectives, like how we discussed for Titanic. That will appear only in center page articles. That will appear only in All India Radio News. That will appear only in RSTV. That will be appearing in Yojana Kurukshetra. Analysis. This is what means. Clear? So first slide, it's about insolvency and bankruptcy definition. So what is this code? The law to regulate it. So who can initiate debtor or creditor? We have discussed about who is financial creditor, who is operational creditor, what are the adjudicating authority. So for individual, automatic fresh start, insolvency resolution. So what is the procedure for automatic fresh start? What is the procedure for insolvency resolution? Right, that we have discussed. For corporate debtor, another thing. For individual debtor, the default amount should be minimum 1000 rupees. Minimum I would have borrowed 1000 rupees. Only then I can approach the DRT. For companies, minimum 1 lakh rupees. Okay. The default amount should be at least 1000 rupees. So two process, insolvency resolution process or liquidation, which we have discussed. When IRP is on 180 days, a 70 percent of consensus has to become maximum 90 days extension. So who is resolution professional? Immediately he appoints a resolution professional. He will take care of the management. He will constitute the IRAS committee. Clear? What are the institutional infrastructure? All the four points we have discussed. So insolvency regulator is an IBBI. 10-member body from RBI and Law Ministry. Insolvency resolution professionals. Information utility. So National E-Governance Services Limited. National E-Governance Services Limited, the government entity which established that centralized database. Okay, that can be a prelims question. Information utility is the country's first utility in bankruptcy, with respect to bankruptcy. This is the first large database with respect to bankruptcy. Adjudicating authority, these are NCLT and NCL Appellate Tribunal, DRT and DR Appellate Tribunal. So November ordinance, the credit worthiness, the credibility of the resolution applicant has to be carefully monitored. And we have set some conditions. If he is a willful defaulter, if he is debarred by SEBI, if he is imprisoned for more than 2 years, he is not eligible. That conditions were announced in 17 ordinance. In 18 ordinance, June 6th, there was an ordinance. Accordingly, an allottee will be considered as a financial creditor. Then the decision majority has been from 75, it has been brought down to 51 or 66 in certain cases. Ineligibility, as I said, for more than 2 years he is ineligible, but that has been brought down to specific cases after 2 years. Then with respect to NPA, more than 1 year is not applicable, but now for financial entity, even more than 1 year, if he is having, if the entity is having NPA, they are eligible to apply. Then the guarantor status, which we have discussed earlier, the guarantor was not allowed to submit a plan. Now he is allowed. Then what? For MSMEs, there is no such conditions. Corporate resolution, if a corporate company wants to apply for resolution, there is one more condition which was been brought by this ordinance. 3/4 of the partners, let's assume that there are 4 partners, myself and 3 of my friends, we are starting a company. Now I want to go for resolution. In that situation, if it's a corporate, 3 of the 4 partners should say yes for the resolution proceedings. Withdrawal, as I said, 90% votes is required from the creditors committee. Another one. So after the order of NCLT, the Guna's corporate will be given 1 year of time. If at all there is some legal obligation, I have to address those legal obligations. Let's say I have to pay some fine penalty, or so I had to submit some documents, whatever. Those legal obligations has to be done within 1 year of the NCLT order. Are you clear? These are the provisions of the ordinance. Very important. Very, very important. Okay. Whenever you come across IBC, also connect IBC with NPAs. How IBC can help in resolving NPA. So you may get a question in mains. Okay. How to resolve NPA. So you can say construction of bad bank, challenges in construction of a bad bank, government has taken some steps through IBC code to resolve the NPA. So the hiccups in IBC has to be addressed. Something like that you can answer. So those analysis will be given in the center page articles too. Clear? So whenever there is some analysis, will come again in the database class. Don't worry. Okay, but you will be having some better clarity now to understand those articles. Doubts? Yes. Any company? Not able to get your point. IBC means insolvency bankruptcy code. Okay, those are government institutions, of course. They are constituted by government. You will have judges in that. Retired judges will be the adjudicators. Of course, yes, of course, yes, of course, yes. The bad bank is something different. That is, it has to travel a long way to come to India. Okay, just a idea which has been proposed by the finance ministry and the former chief economic advisor. He is former now, he has resigned. Okay, right. Next topic, indefinite leave to remain. Indefinite leave to remain. So what is this, sir? See, okay, wait. We'll go for the story. See, in UK, okay, how to go to UK? I will be getting a visa, either a work permit visa or some school education visa, whatever, tourist visa. I go, stay and come. Just by getting the visa, I will not be enjoying all the rights what a citizen is enjoying over there. Right? Now, I want to improve my status in UK. Okay, so what I will do, either I will apply for citizenship, or there's another way that I can improve my status, that is through application for permanent residency status. Okay, permanent residency status, or I can say it as indefinite leave to remain. So I applied. They have given me the status. So now, without any visa or without any conditions for visa, or I will be getting multiple entry visa, I can go to UK at any point of time. I can reside in any part of the UK. I can permanently reside in any part of UK, but I will not be entitled to vote. So I will be treated next to citizens, but I will be treated above the aliens in terms of international relations. Here, aliens means foreigners. Okay, so person from UK comes to India, will call him as alien. Okay, others will be called as citizens. If a person from coming from Pakistan, he will be considered as enemy alien. If it is an enemy state, Pakistan is not an enemy state, it is an all weather friendly state, at least in theory. But I am saying, if he is coming from an enemy state, we ourselves and Pakistan are in war now. A person is coming from enemy state, we will be calling him as enemy alien. So this permanent residents will be having some more advantages in compared to aliens. But he will not be equal to citizens. Okay. Why we are doing this, sir? I'll tell you why it came in news. The next term what we have to understand is deportation. So what is deportation, sir? Forcing someone to leave the country. Okay, UK government asks, like say I am an illegal immigrant in UK. Many illegal immigrants in Malaysia, Indian immigrants in Malaysia, Singapore, they will be kicked off from their country. They will be sent outside their country. They will be, let's say, they will be giving an air ticket and they will be putting them in India. This is called as deportation. What is the another term which came in use, sir? Extradition. So what is extradition? So it refers to, see, let's say, a person has committed some crime in India. Now he is in UK. Now this government is asking UK government to send that person. Let's say that crime may be or may not be a crime in UK, but it is a crime in India. Now he is in UK, I am asking UK government to send that person. If they are sending, that means extradition. This process will happen through two methods. One is either through a treaty or through an agreement. So if India and UK signs a treaty, then any crime in India will be considered as a crime in UK also. So that person will be sent back to India to this treaty. So that UK government has to send back the criminal to India. So one person, he committed a crime, he is seeking asylum in UK. Asylum means what? He is seeking protection in UK. And the UK government, because of this treaty, they are sending back that person to India. If it is an agreement, they may send, they may not send. But mostly they will send, but there is no binding contract between these two countries. India has having extradition treaty with 42 countries, including UK and USA. Agreement with 9 countries. With China, no treaty, no agreement. Commit a crime, go to China. Okay. Yes. I do not know. During war, what is the term for deportation? Either it is deportation or something else. I do not know. I'll check it out. Okay. Right. Yes. Okay. Okay. A UK citizen is committing crime in India. Okay. Now he is going back. It happened recently. Italian mariners, they fired Tamil fisherman, Kerala fisherman. Extradition. Yes. Right. Generally, extradition is, I'll tell you what is it. Okay. It can sometimes, it can be coming under a concept called as fugitive offenders. We'll see what is it. Okay. Listen. So why all this? Yes. Sorry? Treaty is binding. Agreement is oral. It is not binding. May or may not. Right. So why these terms were in news? Vijay Mallya and Nirav Modi both are in UK. Vijay Mallya is a permanent resident of UK. Right? Now, we are taking steps to bring back Vijay Mallya because we have signed extradition treaty between India and UK. But still, UK is delaying the process, citing certain human rights violation in the Indian prisons. Okay, because he is having that PR status of the advocates in the UK courts, Vijay Mallya's advocates, they are saying that we can very well go to India. But there are certain violations in the prisons. The prison condition is very bad. You know, his life is under threat. So first let them, you know, prepare the prison to suit the Vijay Mallya. Then we will send. So there is some politics going on. That is something different. Because of this issue, these terms are appearing in news. Now, drawing clues from Vijay Mallya, Nirav Modi is applying for PR status in UK. He's applied, yet to be given. Okay, so India is taking immediate actions for deportation. Let's not extradict. Let's pressure UK government and let them kick him off from the UK. Clear? So now you might think, is there any such status in India? Yes. In India also we have something called as permanent residency status. For the people of Indian origin, who may be citizens of some other country, but they are peoples of Indian origin, for them we give the status. And also, for certain foreign investors who bring some amount of money, let's say 10 crores within 18 months, 25 crores within 36 months, and they give employment opportunity for 20 people every year. In that situation, not just that person, even the dependents, the spouse are also eligible for permanent residency status in India. They can study here, they can work here. Without, they will be similar to the citizens, but without any voting rights. Are you clear? In India, the status can be renewed for once in 10 years. Once in 10 years, they will check the conditions. If they are satisfying it, it will be renewed multiple times. Clear? Sorry? Not just illegally, if he violates the crime, violates the law, violates constitution, he brings some disturbance, internal disturbance in the country, he can be deported. No. See, deportation means what? What is the difference between extradition and deportation? A crime in India will be considered as a crime in UK. I am asking to bring him. I want to bring him because he has committed some crime in India. What is deportation? There is no involvement of India. He has committed a crime in UK or somewhere else. UK is not looking for him. UK doesn't need him. Some more, he may be a citizen, non-citizen. He wants to send him back to out of the country. Let's assume that he is an illegal migrant. He will be sent back to India from where he has come. Okay, we are taking some routes. We are pressurizing UK to send him out of UK. We will catch him. So, he fearing that he is applying for PR status. Clear? UK, yes. Okay? Yes. All the citizenship based topics, PR status, OCA, overseas Indians, people of Indian origin, non-resident Indian, everything will come under quality, Indian constitution, citizenship chapter. Okay, again I'm telling you, current affairs per se is not a subject. Conventional area, static area will be taken care in class. But it appears in news. If we wait for the completion of static areas, we'll miss out large amount of portion. So what I do, I give some brief idea on those topics. If I have to discuss about citizenship, that itself will take one class. Clear? Got it? So if he marries a newborn, what is the procedure? What is the procedure for naturalization? All those conditions will be discussed. Don't worry. Next one. Fugitive Economic Offenders Ordinance. Fugitive Economic Offenders Ordinance. See, this empowers the authorities, enforcement directorates, other authorities in India to confiscate the property of a person who flee the country. Let's say I have given arrest warrant against Vijay Mallya. If he has borrowed more than 100 crores, I have issued an arrest warrant. Now he flee the country. Now he is in UK. He will be considered as fugitive offender. The owner of the assets is in UK. Now, through this Fugitive Economic Offenders Ordinance, a law came into force through this ordinance. Through this ordinance, this law is empowering the government agencies to confiscate all his property. That is why it was in news. Vijay Mallya's car, Vijay Mallya's plane, Vijay Mallya's house was confiscated. Now it is put to sale. It is put to sale. Money will be recovered, it will be given to the creditors. Why you should say? He is a fugitive offender. Okay. I have done a murder. I will not be informed. You have done a murder, I am going to arrest you. No. Automatically arrest. Right? See, certain acts, we need not go more deep. This is sufficient. But IBC is more important. Okay. That is why we are looking into the each and every provision of the IBC. Next one is RERA. See, often we come across many advertisements, real estate advertisements. Okay, where there will be a mention, RERA approved. Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. Even before that it came. Okay. Yes. Okay. I'm not able to understand your point. Okay. UK, yes. Okay, right, okay. No, no, see, they are not negative. See, that the point is, again, I have to bring human rights. There are certain human rights conventions, okay, which is what they are highlighting. Vijay Mallya's advocate is highlighting those points. UK is a signatory for those international conventions of human rights. Okay, since he is a peer of UK, they are making sure that he is in safe hands. India is being shocked, is getting shocked. We already have a treaty. Why are you looking all at these conditions? Because India is not a signatory for certain conventions. Okay, we'll discuss more. We'll, of course, it's extradition processes. Right, RERA. RERA is a real estate regulatory authority. In 2016, government came with an act called as RERA. Accordingly, every state and every union territory should have a regulator who regulates the real estate projects. Accordingly, any real estate developer, if he develops more than 50 square meters of land or if he builds more than 8 flats, he has to register that project under RERA. He has to upload all the information about that project in RERA's website. Even before initiating the sale, he have to do this. And information about the property will be scrutinized by the RERA. It will be uploaded in the website. If I want to purchase a property, I can simply go to RERA and I can search about the property. After getting some knowledge, I can go and purchase the project. Right? This act is asking the developers to open a separate account called as escrow account. See, let's assume that 10 people are giving 1 crore rupees for purchasing a flat. I am the developer. I get 10 crore rupees. So what I have to do, I have to open an exclusive account. That is called as escrow account. Exclusive account in the bank. I will put the 10 crore rupees on that account. Out of the 10 crores, I will take 30% of that money. I will keep it in my hand. Remaining 70%, that is 7 crores, will be in the bank. With that 30%, I will conduct my operations, right? And whenever required, I can take part of my money. This is made mandatory. Why? Because the real estate developers, they collect money, they chiffon the funds. Chiffoning of funds, that means diversion of funds. I get 10 crores from these people, I invest in some other project, right? To rotation, I do business. When there is some issue, the project will be delayed. This condition was brought down through, was brought by this RERA Act. Clear? And similarly, if the developer is not handing over the project on time, in that situation, the developer has to pay interest for the money which he has got from the investors. Similarly, if the investors, 10 people, if they are not repaying the money on time, in that situation, these people has to pay fine on the amount. Both the developer and also the investor, the real estate allottee, both has to pay some fine if they become a defaulter. For the developer, the obligations or the punishments will be more severe. RERA can even cancel their registration. Right? This is all about RERA. So again, when you take up about RERA, you can also compare IBC, because recently an allottee is now considered as an financial creditor. So now they are finding two avenues. Go to RERA, go to IBC to resolve the problem. Clear? So if there is a issue against the RERA's proceedings or RERA's judgments, there is an appellate authority in every state. Clear? Investor means the purchaser. Held. So if he is not repaying the, let's assume that these people are giving me 50 lakh rupees. And yes, they have promised to pay me 50 lakh rupees after the handover of the project. I have completed the project, but they are not giving me the money. They are not paying the EMA, whatever reason. Okay. Next one is Bharat 22 ETF. Okay, so what is this Bharat 22 ETF? In last class, I briefly discussed about the difference between mutual funds, shares, and also, okay, shares and mutual funds. So what is the difference? Share, I invest my money in one company, company performs, I get profit. Company fails, I face loss. Mutual funds, I want to invest in share market but do not have professional ideas. I look for the help from a professional fund manager. So I am the fund manager, I collect all your money, I invest in different portfolios. I invest in gold, I invest in bonds, I invest in shares, I invest in something else. I make profit, I distribute the profit after taking a commission. Clear? Now there is something called as, not now, ETF is an older concept. Okay, I am introducing you to another concept called as exchange traded fund. Leave Bharat 22. Take only ETF. Exchange traded fund. So what is ETF, sir? ETF is a mixture of both mutual funds and also shares. It is a mixture of both mutual funds and also shares. How it is a mixture, sir? See, this ETF is a kind of mega share. ETF is a kind of mega share, or I can say it is a basket of shares. Okay, I take one ETF, I take one share, only one company is involved. I take one ETF, many companies are involved. ETF is a basket of different companies' shares. One ETF will have more than one company's shares. If I invest in share, I am investing only in one company. If I invest in ETF, I invest in multiple companies. For the sake of understanding, I am saying you, we'll take an analogy. We'll take two analogies. One analogy, I have a land in Nanagar. 5 grounds of land in Nanagar. I have 10 grounds of land in Tambram. I have 20 grounds of land in Chengalpet. I want to sell these lands, not entire lands. Out of 5 grounds in Nanagar, I am taking 1 ground. Out of 20 grounds in Chengalpet, I take 10 grounds. Out of 10 grounds in Tambram, I take, let's say, 1 ground. All together, I make a basket. That basket consists of, let's say, 10 to 12 grounds. I am not selling my entire property. I make a basket. Now, by selling this entire basket, I am selling a part of assets in all the grounds, I mean, all the areas where I was owning some asset. Similarly, government can have ownership or shares in different companies. Bharat 22 ETF means government's shares in 22 companies. Government is having shares in many companies. Are you able to get my point? Government has purchased shares in many companies. Okay. Government has carefully taken some 22 shares, the 22 companies' shares. It made a basket. Now it is selling the entire basket. By selling the entire basket, government is selling its ownership in these 22 companies. We'll take one more analogy. Okay, it will be even more clear. See, mutual funds. You all are giving me money. Now I go to a sweet shop. Okay. These are, let's assume, shares. I go and I see, okay, this sweet is good. Take 1 kg. That sweet is good. Take 2 kgs. This is okay. Take 1/2 kg. I make my own basket. These are shares. Imagine these are shares. I make my own basket. I am not taking entire sweets. I take some parts. I make my own basket. I invest. That performs. I make profit, I give you, I share the profits after taking commission. What is ETF? ETF is an assorted box. Okay, it's an assorted box where various sweets will be present. Various shares will be present, different company shares will be present. It may be equally distributed or it can be differentially distributed. Are you able to understand? I can sell 1 ground in Nanagar, 1 ground in Tambaram, 1 ground in Chengalpet put together. I'm equally distributing, I'm equally selling 1 grounds in each areas. Or I can differentiate it. In five, let's say 2 grounds in Nanagar, 20 grounds in Chengalpet, 3 grounds in Tambaram. That is my wish. This ETF, this box can have differential weighted given shares. By getting one box, I am purchasing different suites. By investing in one ETF, I am investing in different company shares. Okay. Now, the person who is selling this box. Okay. That is India here. Bar 22 ETF is the box, the sweet box created by Indian government. Indian government is having ownership in different companies. Government is having ownership in L&T. Government has some shares of L&T. Government has some shares of ITC.
Government has some shares of Axis Bank. It has shareholdings on government units and also in private units. Now government wants to sell some of its assets to generate income. Government wants to sell. See, we do not sell everything. If I want money, I do not sell all my gold which is available in my home. I sell one ring or I sell one chain for need. Similarly, government has carefully designed the ETF in such a way. They are not selling their entire ownership. They sell a part of their ownership in different companies. In 22 companies, they are selling a part of their ownership. What is the advantage for my for an investor? If I invest in one company, there's a risk. If I invest in ETF, even if L&T is not performing, if ITC is performing, I can make some profit. Something similar to mutual fund. But what is the advantage over mutual fund? In mutual fund, there will be an intermediary. He will take commission. Here, there is no intermediary. Anytime I can purchase, anytime I can sell. What is the advantage for government? Let's say if government sells the shares of ITC separately, government can make more profit because it's a performing company. Assume, let's take this Indian Bank or SJVN. Okay, individually if I sell the shares of those company, we do not know, it may be poor performing companies. Individually it may not be sold, but by putting in a box, government can still sell the assets and make money. Similar to sweet box, separately you may not go for sound property. Right? But in the sweet box, you will also find some body. Yes or no? You may desire for laddu or jangri. Separately, we may not be interested towards bundi or alva or some body, but still you will find some place. Some body. So they are selling that some body also. Yes, yes. Sorry? No, it is not type of mutual. No, it cannot be called as type of mutual funds. Disinvestment. Of course it is disinvestment. Of course, these are disinvestment. Yeah, it can be. What's for? So you are saying that the loss-making PSUs can be brought under ETF. Huh? We can be brought under ETF. Or there's another term that is called as strategic disinvestment. Completely selling of the company. Now, Air India is put not for disinvestment. Doesn't put for strategic disinvestment. We will discuss about that in some other class. Okay, yes. Sorry? Investor. See, your point is correct. But still I will go and purchase because I have ITC shares. I have L&T shares. Individually I may not purchase it. That is the advantage for government I am saying. Just for example, I have taken that SJVN is making loss. We do not know. From government's point of view, I am telling the advantages. From investor point of view, I am telling the advantages. From investor point of view or from UPSC point of view, I am telling what is the difference between share, mutual funds and ETF. More than this not required, right? What? Of course, yes. ETF is a concept. Government can bring, private can bring, anybody can bring. No problem. Right? You often come across these terms like CPA, WPI, MPC, MCLR. All are hardcore economy theory concepts. I'll briefly say what is what. Okay? Consumer price index, wholesale price index is a tool to measure inflation. The tool to measure inflation in consumer products. CPI is a tool to measure inflation in consumer products. WPI is a tool to measure inflation in wholesale products. Okay, Monetary Policy Committee, inflation is over? Yes. What is the relationship between money supply and inflation? Too much of money supply will result in inflation, okay. What is the relationship between interest rates and inflation? Or, I'll ask a question like this. If the interest rates are low, the chances of inflation is high or less? Because money supply is more. If the interest rate is high, the chances of inflation is high or low? Low, because money supply will be reduced because money is more costlier. This Monetary Policy Committee is a committee headed by RBI Governor, 6-member committee headed by RBI Governor, 3 members from RBI, 3 members from government. These 6 people, they will sit. Their main objective is to contain inflation. They will look at the money supply level, or they look at the inflation scenario in the country, and they will influence the interest rates. They will take decisions in such a way that their decisions will influence the market interest rate. If there is inflation, they will take up some decisions that will result in increase in interest rates. If there is a deflationary situation, we have to expand the money supply for economic growth. In that situation, they will reduce the interest. They will influence banks in such a way that banks are reducing the interest rates. So what are the tools they use? That will be taken care in RBI class by Israel sir. So what is MCLR? Marginal cost of lending rates, FOLC. See, as I said, this MPC is going to influence the bank's interest rate. Now, it can only influence. Now, individual banks will be deciding their actual market interest rate. The individual banks decides based on a formula. That formula is called as MCLR. Earlier, that formula is called as base rate. See, different banks has different interest rates. I go put my money in Kotak Mahindra, they give 6% for savings account. I put my money in UOB, they give me only 4%. There are some difference in interest rates. Yes or no? So different banks will have different interest rates, but they will not arbitrarily fix that interest rate. Has some formula. That formula is called as MCLR. Earlier it was based on something called as base rate. Now it is called as MCLR. What is the difference? In what way that MCLR can be influenced by MPC? Everything will be taken care. Don't worry. So economics is over. Go to the polity part. 9 to 9:30. Okay. We'll take a small 3 minutes break. Okay, just for my sake in Chiklame. Okay, so small 3 minutes break. Exactly after 3 minutes I'll start. Right? Right. Next topic. VV part. Now what is VV part? Voter verifiable. Paper audit trial. So earlier we had a ballot system, then we have electronic ballot system. Then now, because of this tampering issues, there are some doubts whether the electronic EVM machines, voting machines can be tampered or not. So in order to bring it more a foolproof mechanism, now they are attaching a VV pad to the EVM machines. So what happens? Let's assume that I press a button for a particular political party. Assume I am pressing a button for XYZ party. Immediately, I will be getting an acknowledgement slip saying that I have voted for XYZ, this candidate, this is my serial number. Now, that paper will be collected in a separate ballot. Whenever there is a doubt, the final output in the EVM can be cross-checked with the final result in the ballot. Right, an election commission, as a practice, they have planned to randomly choose a machine and the complementing, another ballot box, and they are planning to cross-check it. If there is an issue, it will be useful for bringing the credibility over the election system. That is all about VVPAT. Right? Appointments of judges, again it will be taken care in polity class, but still we will see why it was in news. Today, a Supreme Court judge or a High Court judge is appointed by the judges. They are not appointed by some other commission like UPSC. They are appointed by the judges through a process called as collegium process. Okay, if a Supreme Court judge has to be appointed, then a collegium comprising CJA of Chief Justice of India of Supreme Court and 4 senior most judges, they form a team and they choose the Supreme Court judge. If I want to select a High Court judge, then 2 senior most Supreme Court judges along with Chief Justice of the concerned High Court, they will sit and they will select a High Court judge. So you need to know what is a collegium. Okay, so I will be taking in detail about this. Next topic, event report on Kashmir. For the very first time, United Nations came up with a report with respect to the human rights violation happening in both Jammu and Kashmir and Pakistan. Okay, so it is saying Pakistan, it is asking Pakistan to stop the misuse of anti-terror legislation. Let's say I am a civil society activist in Pakistan. I raise slogan against the activities of Pakistan government, they immediately say that I am anti-Pakistan and I am being arrested under anti-terror legislation. That is wrong, UN says. Similarly, in India, we have something called as Armed Forces Special Powers Act. Not protection, change it. Armed Forces Special Powers Act, AFSPA. So, what is AFSPA? Briefly, I will say it will be taken care of in internal security class. Briefly, the armed forces in certain disturbed areas, they are given with large amount of powers. Let's say, for example, I can simply kill anybody if I have a doubt. I can simply arrest anybody without even giving and having a warrant. Okay, without search warrant, I can enter any home. And all these armed forces are protected or shielded from the regular court proceedings. Are you clear? These are the advantages given for the AFSPA. So, how India has reacted? India says this report strongly violates the sovereignty and integrity of the country. And this report is a compilation of unverified information. Alright? Rashtriya Uchita Shiksha Abhiyan RUSA. Listen to me. In 2013, this scheme was brought by HRD Ministry. Okay, in India today, we have more than 800 universities. In this 800 universities, close to 369 universities comes under state-run universities. Okay, 96% of our students are studying in this 369 state-run universities. Right? There are 150 centrally funded institutions like IIM, IIT, or other institutions, centrally funded institutions. They hijack the large amount of money allocated under the education sector. Let's say if 1000 crores of money is being allocated, assume 900 crores goes to building up of new IIT, IITs, expanding the existing IITs, etc. So, what happens? The state-run universities are not given sufficient funds. The state government is also not focusing more on higher education, rather they focus more on school education. Are you clear? So, these private universities are having dearth of funds. The HRD Ministry in 2013, they came up with a plan, they came up with a scheme that is called as RUSA. According, it's a conditional scheme. It is a voluntary scheme. If a state wants the money, saints want some money through this RUSA, they have to express their willingness. Okay, so it's a conditional funding scheme. That means HRD Ministry says, see, if you bring some reforms in your education department, I will give you some funds. Let's say, for example, improve the infrastructure, improve the take measures to improve the gross enrollment ratio, take measures to fill the vacancies of teachers. Some reforms you have to bring, clear? And those reforms, based on the reforms, we will be giving you some grants. Clear? Right? So now, this RUSA is a centrally sponsored scheme. So what is meant by centrally sponsored scheme, sir? There are two kinds of scheme. One is centrally sponsored, another one is central sector. Central sector scheme is completely funded by the government. Okay. Centrally sponsored schemes means it is partly funded by central government, partly funded by respective state governments or UTs. Clear? So this is a centrally sponsored scheme. Accordingly, 60% of the funds will come from central government and 40% of the funds will come from state governments. For normal regular states, for special category states, 90% of the funds will come from central government and 10% will come from state governments. So what is special category states, we'll see. So recently, Union Cabinet, they decided to continue this scheme. They found the scheme to be more useful. They want to continue this scheme. So what is special category status? In India, there are 11 states where we have special category status. 3 Himalayan states, Jammu and Kashmir, Uttarakhand, Himachal, and 8 Northeastern states. Sikkim, Assam, Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, Tripura, Mizoram, Manipur, Meghalaya. Right? So what are the conditions for declaring a state as a special category state? So I have given the conditions. Hilly and difficult terrain, low population density or sizable share of tribal population, strategic location along the borders of neighboring countries, and economic and infrastructural backwardness, and non-viable nature of state finances. Andhra Pradesh state is looking for special category status based on the last point, non-viable nature of state finances, because earlier, erstwhile Andhra Pradesh, United Andhra Pradesh, large amount of almost 70% of the revenue was coming from Hyderabad alone. Now Hyderabad has gone to Tripura, sorry, Telangana. So Andhra is lacking viability for improving their finances. So they are asking special category status. If that status is given, large amount of grants will come from central government. Are you clear? The rules are, as I said, these are the facts which I have mentioned, 800 universities, etc. Conditional release of funds. Right? So except Lakshadweep, every state and other UT has taken up this RUSA. For current year, government has allocated 1,300 crores. Recently, it was in news. Some 400 crores of money has been granted to Tamil Nadu universities. That is why it was in news. But that information is not required. What is the scheme that we have to know? Right? Performance. So some performance was also mentioned in the article. So after the implementation or the introduction of RUSA, the gross enrollment ratio has increased to 25.2% from 19.4%. People who are joining colleges, that enrollment ratio has improved. Similarly, the teacher-student ratio from 1:24, it has been brought down to 1:20. For every 20 students, we will be having one teacher. And similarly, with respect to faculty vacancies, earlier the vacancies were 60%, now that has been reduced to 35%. Clear? Earlier, the vice chancellors were selected based on political preferences. Now, there is some clear-cut mechanism. Many states are following certain mechanism, a merit-based system to recruit the vice chancellor. These are some of the achievements or performance of RUSA. Right? Comprehensive newborn screening. So Kerala became the first state to introduce comprehensive newborn screening. See, first state, last state, okay, largest, biggest, smallest, deepest, everything you have to know. Whenever you come across the news, please highlight it. It will be highly effective for prelims. So what is this comprehensive screening, sir? A newborn within 48 hours will be completely screened to check whether is there any abnormalities, is there any disorders, is there any metabolic disorder, birth defect, neurodevelopmental issues, functional defects. Within 48 hours, they will be checking out all the abnormalities. Those abnormalities will be sent to some centralized agencies, government agencies. They will be having that big data. So they have the complete data of the next generation. Right, with which they can take actions to protect their resource, because they are seeing human as a capital, human as a resource. If the citizens of the country is well, is healthy, then it is a rich human resource. They can, their skills can be upgraded, they can be put to use, our economy can be developed. Kerala is the first state to bring this screening in all government hospitals, in public healthcare centers. Private, they are doing it. Clear? Now they are having a database, but what is more important? We will go to science news. Okay. Nipah virus. So Nipah, according to WHO, Nipah virus is a newly emerging zoonosis. Nipah is a newly emerging zoonosis, which is zoonosis means what? It is transmitted from animals to human. Animals to human, animals to animals. Okay, human is also an animal. Okay, so animals to humans, so transmitted to humans from animals, both are same. It was first documented in Malaysia in 1998. It is believed that it has been transmitted from bats, from the respiratory droplets of bats or some excretion of bats. It is assumed that from bats it have reached the pigs. From pigs, it have entered the humans. Clear? So 1998 in Malaysia, in Bangladesh, in 2000, we witnessed an outbreak of Nipah in Bangladesh. And it was assumed that, or it was found that it was transmitted from one person to another person through respiratory droplets. It is also an airborne disease. I have Nipah, I simply sneeze, you inhale, you also get Nipah. Clear? And it entered West Bengal twice. From Bangladesh, because West Bengal has borders with Bangladesh, and entered Bangladesh, entered West Bengal through Bangladesh in two places, one in Siliguri and Nadia. Where is Siliguri? In West Bengal, where is Siliguri? Why Siliguri is important? See? Yes. This small junction, okay, just 30 kilometers in diameter length, okay, the small junction, that is called a Siliguri corridor. If I simply choke that point, the entire northeast will be disconnected. That is very, very important. What is Doklam issue? Where is Doklam? Where is Bhutan? Right, see, this area is where we have Bhutan, yes or no? And this area we have Siliguri corridor, yes or no? That Siliguri corridor is more closer to Doklam. Doklam issue is a dispute between China and Bhutan, but why India is interfering? If Doklam is taken by China, then they'll be having easier access to Siliguri. They simply put one bomb in Siliguri, or they simply control Siliguri, just 30 kilometers. If they control, then the entire northeastern states can be taken by China. That is why India has involved in the Doklam issue. Siliguri is very important. So through the Siliguri, there was an outbreak witnessed in West Bengal. Right. So now recently we saw an outbreak in Kerala. Right. So what is the signs and symptoms? Since it is an airborne, it can be transmitted through air. It can be transmitted to contaminated bodies. It results in inflammation of brain. It brings fever. Sometimes if it unnoticed, it might even lead to coma in 48 hours. Right? Prevention. There is no particular prevention. Still clinical trials are going on with respect to producing the vaccines. So what is the only way? You simply segregate those people, give intensive care unit to them, control the outbreak first, and by just giving the regular treatments, help them in recovering. There is no particular vaccination or vaccine which is available to treat, a particular medicine to treat Nipah so far. Clear? Selfish gene. So these are Sunday news. I am also including last Sundays because Sunday you'll be getting science related news. Okay. Selfish gene. So what is selfish gene, sir? See, in a cell, we have nucleus. In nucleus, we have genes. We have genes. In genes, we have DNA. This DNA produces proteins. We say it is expression. Okay, it produces proteins. Now what happens? There are certain DNAs. Let us assume, just for layman understanding, I am saying, let us assume for producing the proteins, we need some capacity. Each DNA needs some capacity to produce the protein. Okay. So it's I am on DNA, she is on DNA, she is on DNA, all are DNAs. Now what I do, I am selfish DNA. To produce, to express my protein, I take up the capacities of other DNAs. So these people are not able to produce protein. This is called as selfish gene. Are you clear? So what is, why it came in news? See, while crossing the wild type rice with domestic rice, scientists were able to find selfish gene. How they were able to find? They crossed it. The final output was sterile. The final seed was not able to give birth to another seed because it turned sterile because of the selfish gene. I am crossing two different breeds. That results in formation of some selfish genes. That selfish genes, it controls the capacities of other DNAs, other genes. Because of this selfish gene, that particular crop is not able to be used for further plantations or growths. Are you clear? Right? So this sterile selfish gene, this selfish gene makes the crop sterile. It affects the pollen formation. So the hybrid variety of seed is of no use. With that seed, you know, it cannot result in further more seeds. That is the point because of the impact of selfish gene. Next is Zika virus and tumor necrosis factor alpha. Zika virus and tumor necrosis factor alpha. So what is Zika virus, sir? So Zika virus, the name Zika was because of the outbreak was found in Uganda in a forest called as Zika. That is why you call it as Zika virus. So what are the symptoms? Fever, red eyes, joint pain, headache, etc. All these things, you know. So how to diagnose it? I can diagnose it by testing the blood, urine or saliva. What is more important, sir? How it is being transmitted? This can be asked in prelims. Transmission through mosquito bites, from pregnant woman to baby, through sexual contact, through blood, by through blood transfusion. Clear? So what is the infection? Or the problem, main problems caused by this Zika virus? One is Guillain-Barré syndrome and microcephaly. Microcephaly is very common. You should be knowing it. So Guillain-Barré syndrome. If this Zika virus attacks me, it collapses my nervous system. That is this Guillain-Barré syndrome. Another one is microcephaly. Microcephaly means what, sir? The brain does not develop completely. So actually, see, this is the actual brain formation. Because of the poor brain formation, the head of the child changes into a different shape. So the brain formation is not complete. So the head becomes smaller than normal. Right? Generally, when the transmission is caused from mother to baby, then the baby is largely affected by microcephaly issue. Again, there is no vaccination, there is no one particular vaccine or medicine to control the infections caused by Zika. So why it was in use? What is the prevention, sir? Nothing. Avoid mosquito bites. Right? So why it was in use? The tumor necrosis factor alpha. Because of tumor necrosis factor alpha, it was in use. So what is this tumor necrosis factor alpha, sir? Just now we discussed. A cell has nucleus, nucleus has gene, gene has DNA, DNA expresses protein. Yes or no? So there are certain DNAs which expresses protein. By certain expression, it signals something. When it signals something, I call it a signaling cell or signaling protein. Cell signaling protein. Let's say the signal is for example, let's say this tumor necrosis factor alpha will generally present in it's a cell. Basically, it's a cell protein. Sorry, this tumor necrosis factor alpha is a protein that is released by certain DNAs that is present in muscular tissues. In muscular tissues, tissue is what? Group of cells is tissue. Okay, so in that cell, we have nucleus, we have DNA that releases protein. That protein results in inflammation in certain areas. That inflammation, vingi porudhu, that is the signal. So such proteins are called as, or such cells are called as cell signaling proteins. Right? And this cell signaling protein causes microcephaly. So if I am able to control that, if I am able to stop that expression, if I am able to stop that cell signaling, then I can control inflammation, I can control microcephaly. Are you able to understand? That is why it was in use. Now they found the trick. How to control that microcephaly? How to control that brain inflammation? Clear? So because by blocking this tumor necrosis factor alpha in newborns, then the abnormalities can be prevented in the adulthood. It is an anti-inflammatory treatment. See, if there is an inflammation here, I can put some ointment. If there is an inflammation in brain, what I have to do? So we are stopping the cause. There is some cell signaling protein that results in inflammation. If I am able to stop that cell signaling, if I am able to stop that DNA from expressing that protein, I can very well stop that inflammation. Clear? Generally, how they will ask in prelims? Tumor necrosis factor alpha was in use. Is related with which among the below? Zika virus, Nipah virus, H1N1, none of the above. You have to choose is Zika. That's all. That is sufficient. Or they might give microcephaly, blood pressure, something they might give. Choose microcephaly. More than this, nothing is required. Don't go and do any other research. We need to know about something, what they are doing it, what is the developments, in what way they can benefit the society. Clear? Next one is antibacterial, polythene and silver nanoparticles. So what is this antibacterial, polythene and silver nanoparticles, sir? What is nanoparticle? size of 10 power minus 9, very small. Okay, so people have found that these nanoparticles with some chemical composition, these nanoparticles are inorganic, it is made by inorganic compounds, not organic compounds. Okay, these nanoparticles made up of with some inorganic compounds, when that is mixed with the clay, imagine that I take some nanoparticles, you cannot see it literally through your eyes, I am taking some nanoparticles, I take some clay, I mix it, okay, I embed that paste in a plastic and I roll it, I make it into a thin films, like how I make chapatis. Imagine, I make it into thin films. This thin final film is exhibiting certain antimicrobial functions, activities. That means it prevents formation of bacterias. Let us assume I bring lunch prepared by home. I come to office by 7 o'clock. I generally get time to eat only by 3 or 4 o'clock. In the meantime, the food is getting contaminated, not because of the food, because of the tiffin box I am having. Because of the tiffin box, because of that chemical conception, there is a microbe attack. Right? Now imagine I am making use of this chemical which I have, not chemical, this component which I have devised. Now I make that into a tiffin box, or I use that in making a tiffin box, or I am covering the tiffin box through this layer. Now what is going to happen? It is going to prevent my tiffin box from microbial attacks. For tiffin box, they won't use it. The application is broader. Okay, let's say for example, biomedical field, they will be using it. For example, in operation theaters, there should not be no microbial attacks. So where these nanometers have the combination of plastic and clay can be used for preventing these bacterial attacks. And similarly, have you heard about this E. coli? What is E. coli? Sorry? Okay, it is present, bacteria again, it is present in our the intestines, digestive tracts, okay, that causes many problems. Now, the research is going on, using this combination, some composition, if the nanometer is taken inside, that results in removing of these E. coli. Right, the combination of this particular kind of nanometer and clay and plastic is compatible with our, it is biocompatible with our human body. Are you clear? The applications are wider. Indian researchers have found, they found some breakthrough. Okay, so these applications will be developed and can be used in various fields. Right? Nanomotors. Again, it's a nanoparticle. What is nanoparticle is going, nanomotor is going to do? See, this nanoparticle, when it is given some energy that exhibits some movement. Let us say, most of you are engineers, right? When I excite an electron, the electron brings some movement, that movement brings some energy, that is called as electricity. Yes or no? Current. Right. So similarly, this nanometer, if it is given some energy, that exhibits some movement. Now what Indian scientists have found? They found self-propelling nanomotors. It itself can move. You need not give any energy consistently, continuously. Itself can move. Earlier, I have some, let's say this is an example of nanomotor. Assume it moves like a fan. It rotates and also it moves. Imagine, okay. So, earlier I give some energy, some form of energy, maybe in the form of heat or maybe in the form of light, something I give some energy, it moves. Now, Indian research found self-propelling nanomotors. They are saying that which can be useful for treating the water. How, sir? See, nanorods is a kind of nanomotors. These nanorods is put into a, let's say, a ditch or some contaminated water body. I am putting some nanometers or nano rods in that contaminated water body. Now what I do, I put some thing called as hydrogen sulfate in that contaminated water body. This hydrazine sulfate, which reacts with water to produce nitrogen. This process results in some osmotic stress. That osmotic stress is making the nano rods to move. Are you able to get my point? So let's assume that's a tank, contaminated tank. I put some nano rods, I put some hydrogen sulfate, then this results in production of nitrogen, that results in some osmotic stress, that results in movements of nano rods. So nano rods travels, and during this travel, because of the structure, because of the chemical combinations, it attracts the contaminants. It attracts the contaminants, it moves towards the, in a complete, it completely revolves around that contaminated water body. It collects all the contaminants, it settles in one place. It can be filtered out. Are you clear? See, science and technology will result in considerable environmental damage. Again, that damage can be reduced only through science and technology. If you take this sterilite protest in Thoothukudi, people are protesting not against sterilite. They are protesting against the pollution caused by sterilite. Yes or no? Imagine if sterilite is an eco-friendly production unit. Think anybody is going to protest? No. When we go back to the history, Thoothukudi was not having sufficient employment. So there was a threat or spread of Naxalism. During MGR, when he was chief minister, so he conducted a collectors meet and he was discussing what can be done. So they said that unemployment is the main problem, we will bring large amount of industries. So during his period, industrial clusters were created, SIPCOT was created. That was for the benefit of public. But that resulted in contamination of water and other, it resulted in water pollution and air pollution. So to control that, because of that people are fighting. So if through this technology breakthrough, if you are able to control that contamination, there will be no problem in continuing the sterilite. If at all they ask mains or interview, always bring science for your help. Don't completely outrightly reject what the public has done is wrong, what the police has done is wrong. See, of course, shooting is different. They're not going into that even. I'm telling a larger picture. What government has done is wrong. No, more than that, you criticize, you constructively criticize, you explain the challenges, right? But in the solution, you bring science. Science is the only hope which can solve all the problems, right? Another thing called as nanosphere. Okay, another thing is called as nanosphere. So nanosphere, it is not self-propelling. Here, when I give some light, it is getting excited, it moves. So imagine I am having vacuum cleaner in my hand. And I do the cleaning process. Like that, I have a torch in my hand. I put some nanometers, nanosphere in the contaminated water body. By moving the light, I can move the nanospheres, and that nanospheres is going to collect, absorb all contaminants, and that can be filtered out. I'm giving a layman explanation. Don't think light will be moved like this. Okay, it's a technological breakthrough. Indian researchers have found it. It will take some more time. Practically use it. Okay. So paper 3, we have a separate topic called as science and technology, where more importance is given to Indian findings, Indian breakthroughs. Right? So you can expect a question on applications of nanometer. Or maybe in wastewater treatment, there is a question. You can also bring science and you can explain about nanometer. Right? Or simply they can ask, what is nanometer? What are the applications in nanometer and UPSC? Option A, nanometer can be used in what? Option A, in sewage treatment. Yes, answer is yes. But generally our common sense say nano motor, how that can be used in, cleaning the contaminants. It can. Right? Application water treatment. So large solid waste can be filtered out easily. But certain chemical compounds which cannot be easily filtered out can be taken care by these nanoparticles. Clear? OTCS and Omsensia. What is it? See, I hope you know this history. One history is strongly believed in geography. History is believed in geography. What history, sir? Earth is a part of sun. Not just Earth. All the planets were once a part of sun. They got broken and now they are revolving around sun due to the gravitational force. Clear? Over a period of time, the Earth got cooled. And Earth were receiving rain. And all this rain, along with some thunder activity, that resulted in development of nitrogen. Okay, that resulted in development of some DNA. DNA releases protein, where nitrogen is an important component. And from water bodies, the first life found its place. And that water, that aquatic organisms later developed into amphibian. And that entered land. It is believed that the first step taken by the amphibian was in tropical areas. Now, a recent study says that even before 70 million years of that instance, the same kind of organism, it entered the Arctic Circle. So, we are believing that the first animal to walk on land was this Durishetty Anudeep, a tetrapod organism like a frog. We were four-legged organism, yes. So we were thinking that it entered a tropical region, 23 and a half north to 23 of south, somewhere in India, let's assume. But now, even before 70 million years, it entered the Arctic region. That was the finding. That is why it was in news. Lake Baikal. Take Atlas and find Baikal. It is in Russia. See, every current affairs class, please bring Atlas. Now we'll move on to IR. Okay. So find Baikal Lake in Russia. Yes, of course, above Mongolia. Found Lake Baikal. It is the world's largest freshwater lake by volume. 23% of world's freshwater is with that one lake. It is world's largest freshwater lake, world's deepest lake. It also holds 23% of world's fresh surface water. Okay, but also it has been recognized as UNESCO's World Heritage Site. We'll see about UNESCO later. Okay, some important sites will be given some status by UNESCO. We'll discuss about that later. So you saw Baikal. Okay, now you see Mongolia. Now tell me, Mongolia is bordered by which countries? You see the map. China, Russia, Kazakhstan. China by two sides. Okay, so important point here is Mongolia is a landlocked country. So these landlocked countries can be asked in UPSC. They simply ask, Mongolia is surrounded by which among the following countries? Russia, China, India, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, Azerbaijan, something they'll give. We have to choose. Don't think randomly they'll choose Mongolia. If Mongolia comes in news, we have to be very particular. Now, Baikal is in news. So, Lake Baikal is closer to Mongolia. So, we also see about Mongolia. They might ask, they might give some statement. Lake Baikal is shared by both Mongolia and Russia. China and Russia. Statement is wrong. Baikal is completely inside Russia. Right? So, why it was in news, sir? So, the algae. There was some formation of algae in the kind of like a mat, the Lake Baikal. So, Malapasi Mari formed. There was some algal bloom. Okay. So, that algal bloom is now covering the entire Lake Baikal. Not entire, most parts of Lake Baikal. So what is the issue with respect to this mat forming algae? It stops the light, sunlight penetrating inside that aquatic region. That affects the marine organism, that freshwater organisms. That affects the aquatic plants. Are you able to get my point? This algal is forming a mat. It is not allowing the light to penetrate. So the organisms beneath that mat is facing large amount of threat. That is why it was in news that something called as eutrophication. Eutrophication, that will be taken care of in environmental class. So what happens is algal. This algae is nothing but cyanobacteria. This bacteria, maybe they are thinking due to some industrial discharge, due to some agricultural waste discharge. The cyanobacteria for that agricultural waste or industrial waste may be an interesting food for that cyanobacteria. Eating that food, the cyanobacteria has developed into a green mat algae. Are you clear? So this might disturb the aquatic life as they block the sunlight. That is why it was news. Some miscellaneous news. Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay. Okay, it was politically, it was mentioned, but still, since it came in news, we will discuss. So Vande Mataram was composed and written by Bankim Chandra. What about Janagana Manadi? Written by Tamil Nadu. Excellent. So this Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay is not just famous for Vande Mataram. He is also famous for his fiction called as Anand Math. In 2017, 18 prelims, there was a mention about Anand Math. The question was like this. Which among the below is the oldest? That was the question. They gave Anand Math. Anand Math was written somewhere in 1800s. Okay. Not 1800s. Yes. Leave the chronological term. Anand Math. And they gave something called as Neel Darpan. Anand Math deals about this Sanyasi Rebellion. This Neel Darpan deals about Indigo Revolution. Similarly, they gave some four works. And they asked which is the oldest. Okay. So what is this Anand Math? Briefly, I will say, history ma'am will be taking care of it. So in late 18th centuries, that means 1760s, 1770s, this Bureau, British East Indian Company, they got control over West Bengal. They got something called as Diwani rights. They'll say some administrative rights, imagine. Now revenue rights are also with Britishers. Earlier, before the rulers were giving money to the sannyasis who were present in Bengal for their holy trips. Let's say Buddhist monks. Okay, or some other people who want to carry out those holy trips. Now these Britishers, they stopped funding. They started rebel. Okay, they raised uprising. They started a rebellion group against the Britishers. That is called a Sanyasi Rebellion. So these events were written in that book. Okay, and that book found a mention in UPSC. Clear? Okay, Diocha Pachami. Right, it is in West Bengal. World's second largest coal block. And country's largest coal block is in West Bengal. So usually, the coal block will be awarded to private players for mining. So private players mine and they give it to government. For the mining process, government will be giving license. And the license can be obtained through selection process. Okay. Everybody, the participants will be given through auctioning process. Here, West Bengal also participated and West Bengal government won the contract. Now they are going to do the coal mining in the coal block which is present in their state. What is more important? Second largest in the world, largest in India. Where it is present? It is West Bengal. Right? Another important point which we have to know is the difference between coal block and coal mine. What is coal block? So coal block is measured in terms of depth. The depth length I will take. Okay, from here it goes till 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers. That length of depth will be calculated. That is called as coal block. What is coal mine? The place where I do the mining. Understood? Right? Next topic. So IR. We'll just start IR, okay? I'll just briefly say about the SEO summit. So what is SEO? Shanghai Cooperation Organization. After the disintegration of USSR, 1991, okay? This is Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan. Just to see the states surrounding China. Eurasian countries. Right? Just see where is Kazakhstan, where is Uzbekistan, where is Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan. It's Kazakh, Uzbek, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan. See, go to Eurasian map. Don't go to world map. Or take Russia. See, if you are able to see, no problem. You're fine. You saw China, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan. With which countries China shares border? Just keep China in center and check what are the countries sharing border with China. And just tell me whether Russia is bordering China. Yes or no?
Yes.
Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan. Okay, leave Uzbekistan. Now, yes or no? No. Yes or no? No, right. So, after the disintegration of USSR, these five countries, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, they were having some border issues with China. To settle the border disputes, they constituted something called as Shanghai 5 in 2001. Okay. To that Shanghai 5, later Uzbekistan also joined. Okay, so there were 6 members in Uzbekistan. Gradually, they expanded their mandate. Okay, now 18th SEO summit, which was recently held, that is why it was news. It was recently held in China, in Qingdao. Right? So what are the objectives of SEO? Strengthening of mutual trust. Neighborliness, effective cooperation among the member countries with respect to politics, trade, economy, research, technology, culture, education, energy, tourism, everything. Right? What is, why it is more important, sir? SEO will be taken care of by sir. Don't worry. I'm just introducing you. Okay, SEO is a bigger thing, very important. How SEO is important for India? Definitely we can expect a question in mains this year for become SEO because India became a member of SEO in 2017 and the 18th SEO summit is the first summit where India is participating as a permanent member. Along with India, one more country also got membership. Pakistan. So India is thinking, it is trying to use this opportunity to rebalance the ties with the Pakistan. If Pakistan is somehow getting cooperated because this SEO is having several mandates. With respect to, see, we just saw, right? Strengthening mutual trust, neighborliness, etc., etc. Right? When they behave like a single block, a single block is going to give some uniform factors. So, Pakistan can be made into a potential neighbor for us. It might even act like a gateway to reach the Middle East. If I want to reach Middle East, I have to go only through Iran. See, where is Iran? Atlas lang close panadinge. See, where is Iran? West of Iran. If I want to enter Afghanistan, now I am going to Iran. From Iran, I am coming to Afghanistan. Right? So, there is something called as Chabahar port, which we are developing in Iran. There is something called as Chabahar port, which we are developing in Iran. From that port, I am trying to take the needs for Afghanistan. Or from that port, I am trying to reach the Middle East. Because there is no proper friendliness between India and Pakistan right now. SEO can be used for to rebalance the tie so that it can even act like a gateway for the Middle East. So SEO is very important. Not just that. So now India is getting exposed to large number of neighbors who are in not Southeast, that is Asia. Here it is Central Asia. Central Asia is having large amount of energy resources. So this SEO can be a gateway for India to tap the energy potential in Central Asian countries. And also, there's an increasing enmity between China and India. Sometime it spikes, sometime it falls. Yes or no? So what we are going to do? Neighbor is? See, enemy's friend. But then again, right, fine. Or enemy's neighbor is? Whatever combination. China, every neighbor, politically if you see, every neighbor will be an enemy for any country, generally. So what, for China, either the Kazakhstan or Turkmenistan, they are going to have some friction with China. So India is trying to build some strong relationship between other countries so that it can control China. In order to, so China was not able to stop India's entry into SEO. So to control India, China is bringing Pakistan. So you can check India, right? But leave that apart, but leave that geopolitics, but there is a huge energy potential for India which can be tapped through this SEO. So on these perspectives, they'll be asking question. It means they will not ask what is SEO, what is the structure of SEO, what is the objective. They'll be connecting India and SEO. They'll be connecting China and SEO. They'll be connecting entry of India and SEO, something like that. And how it is useful for us? Energy and India and SEO. In these perspectives, we have to try to understand that topic. And that understanding will come only through analysis that appears in center page articles. So don't skip editorials. Clear? So now the 8 members, India, Kazakhstan, China, Kyrgyzstan, Pakistan, Russia, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan. Right? Maybe we can expect a question. Usually they used to ask a question, which among the following countries are surrounded by Uzbekistan? Clear? The structure, there are 2 permanent bodies. There is one secretariat in Beijing for SEO, and the another permanent body is called as RATS, Regional Anti-Terrorist Structure. It is based in Tashkent, Uzbekistan. Right? So what is Tashkent? Why it is famous? Something called as Tashkent Summit. It happened somewhere. Yes, Lal Bahadur Shastri, we do not know whether he was assassinated or what. That's a mysterious death. He went to Uzbekistan, Tashkent, to sign some agreement where he died mysteriously. Tashkent Summit. Clear? So this RATS is headquartered in Uzbekistan, Tashkent. Secretariat of SEO is in Beijing. So RATS is one of the feature of SEO where they try to promote cooperation among the members to tackle terrorism, separatism, extremism, off late, even to tackle drug exports. Because drug is a serious issue in these countries. Okay? To control the movement of drugs, RATS is being useful. So imagine, now Pakistan, India is a part of SEO. That means part of RATS. That means 2 armed forces are going to work together. That itself is going to bring some friendliness. Are you able to get my point? Even in this aspect, you can see. You can approach this SEO. Clear? So whenever you study, try to create some questions on your own. Initially, it might be difficult, but try to create. And gradually, you try to give some answer. Then mains will be a cakewalk. Without doing this, if you simply go to some websites and simply try to answer the questions which they give, it will be of no use. First, try to have some content. You should have some raw material. Know how to cook. Go to the exam. They might order you some dish based on the raw material. Prepare the food and give it to them. Try to make it more tastier so that you will get more score. So at the end of the day, this is a cook show. Fine. So 18th SEO Summit, what are the highlights? Disarmament, drug trafficking, whatever. See, these are things which you can simply by understand by reading it. Okay, I have given the summit highlights. So where is in Davao? I have given in the map. In this 18th SEO summit, our Prime Minister, he floated a concept called as SECURE. Okay, he's expanding, he made acronym SECURE. S for security, E for economic development. So he wants SEO to be used in such way. Right? Unity, respect of sovereignty, integrity, environment protection, etc. These are the member countries. Mongolia will not come. Iran will not come. Okay, Pakistan, India, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Russia, China. Leave Mongolia and leave Iran. Only 8 members and they are observers. Observers means they come, they participate in the meeting, they observe, they, if they want, they can give some suggestions, but they are not entitled for voting. Earlier, India was an observer. Now, India is a permanent member. Now, these people are also looking for membership. Clear? So, we'll stop here. We'll meet in next class. So, next class. See, one more thing. Listen. One more thing. The magazine will be uploaded. It's called as Pulse. Uploaded. Oh, good. How was it? Okay, fine. So, make use of that magazine because I cannot cover all the topics. The entire magazine has been divided into two. What? One is at a glance, another one is in depth. Okay. In depth articles you can read and you can understand. By keeping names in mind, I have developed it. Next class, we will do this North Korea and USA issue. We'll try to finish the remaining IR current affairs. Then we'll move on to next week's topic. Okay. So, all the best. I hope the class was useful. Right, we'll see you next class. Thank you.